Good morning, all. Good morning. I think you're all fresh after tea and tea break. So first of all, I would like to extend my thanks to ICT Academy and also my company, Oracle, for allowing me to come and present myself here. So thank you. The next thing is, I would also like, I know like we're all grown up with Matru Devova, Pitru Devobhava, and Acharya Devova, right? So I just want to first thank all the teachers here or acknowledge all the teachers here. Without Vishnu, I think we are not going to be like this, right? So a big round of applause for all the teachers. Because the skill is very much related to the teachers. They need to, it is a continuous thing for them to inculcate that within the students. So definitely you play a major role in this whole journey. So coming to my talk today, I'll try to structure it in such a way that let's probably talk about some challenges what we have today. And I think probably what I can say is challenges can be our goals too, because we want to overcome those challenges, right? So that is the first thing. Second thing is, let's also try to understand what we can do from a skill standpoint. What are all the various things? How we all can probably look at skills? Because today we hear a lot of buzzwords, right? We keep talking or we keep listening about digital transformation. We keep listening about disruption. We keep talking about reskilling, a lot of these things. And also from a technology standpoint, we keep talking about machine learning, artificial intelligence, cloud. So what are all these things? So we get lost. Actually, where to start and how to take this forward, right? So let's, as part of this 20-25 minute session, I'll try to put some structure on how we can take this together. And again, what are all our roles, right? As an academy, what you guys can contribute and how the industry can contribute and how the government can probably help in doing the policy making. So with all this, how we three can collaborate in probably doing something. So that is what was the agenda. So without any further delay, I'll just start my first slide. As I mentioned, first is, this is more from a policy making statement where, no, we want to take the education to the masses, right? So you might be wondering, it is already there. What is that we need to do more? Or what is that the government need to do more is, see, today some of these greatest life skills and whatever we are talking about, they're all more refined or constrained to the corporate school. So I think we need to think about how we can take it to the government schools and all that. That's probably for the policymakers. And second is, the minimize the ramp-up training costs. This was the Hemachandra Reddy was talking about, right? How we can make the students more employee ready and all that. So that is what, that way that can cut down the cost for the companies. The third thing is, for the academia, what is important is how they can deliver the quality education, how they can probably align themselves to the latest changing technologies. That is what is the goal for the academia. And last but not the least, what is there for the students? So along with all these three, students also play a major role here, right? So for students, the big concern is they keep listening about artificial intelligence and sometimes they feel that, okay, whether we're going to get the jobs or whether our jobs are going to be taken away by the robots. So this is what is some dilemma, right? So I think we also need to probably look at how this can be addressed and all that, right? So these are some of the goals I'm trying to address. And for all of that, the common thing is our skill, okay? So with that context setting, so let's move on to the next slide. These are some of the strengths what we have today, right? Again, this is something we were talking in the morning also, other speakers were talking about it. So we are one of the largest producers of engineering graduates in the world. And you don't believe, along with us, China, US, Korea, and some of the other countries are there. So this is a great strength to us. Similarly, employability skills is a concern requiring industry to invest more. This is one of the things which I was talking. So we need to see how we can address this. Opportunities, again, this was discussed in the morning, that the average age of the youth population in India is around 65%. This is by 2020. That's what the survey says or the number says. So I think this is a huge strength for us, huge opportunity. But we need to see how we can convert this opportunity into our benefit, right? That is something we need to look at. So the important thing which we need to worry about is the research education. That is, again, sir was talking in the morning, right? So research is one area where we need to think a lot, because we know as a country we have so many great eminent scientists and all that. But in the recent past, if you really see whether we have any Nobel Prize in science and technology, no. So though we got in other streams, but if you really look at science and technology, we still have a lot of opportunity and scope to do. So I think that is one thing probably we need to look around. And even in one of the surveys, what they're saying is, if US is generating around 40,000 of PhDs, or and China is doing around 35,000, India is at around 13 to 12,000. So I think there's a huge gap. And that high-skilled generation of our people is very important for us to contribute to the economy too, right? So these are some of the things which I just want to put it forward to you. This is our as-is condition, okay? Sorry, something is wrong. It's not going forward. Sorry for the pause. So I think we set the context now. We understood the our strengths and what is our current state, where we need to focus and all that. So the next thing is the topic of today, right? Augmenting skills, how we can do it. So I just tried to stream it. This is more of a preparatory slide in the sense I thought of talking to you about first preparing yourself for the skill revolution. And the next slide will be more about how we can practically do it or practically implement it. So if you look at this slide, I have three streams. Education is one, infrastructure is one, and the soft and behavioral aspects is the another one. So if you look at the education, what is that we can do? What is that an industry can do or a policymakers can do means? First thing is the course curriculums, course design. These are some of the areas where I think we can do a lot of collaboration. For example, you might have heard about it. The government, the CBSE, the Central Board of Secondary Education has already partnered with IBM and Microsoft for introducing the AI curriculum, AI in their curriculum. That is one thing. And they're also talking about how they can skill their teachers on the digital technologies. So that is definitely one aspect which I want to highlight here. Similarly, there is one initiative by McDonald's, which is partnering with Neswadia, one of the colleges, management colleges. What they are doing is they are offering a course in BBA that is with the specialization as retail operations. So that way, what is happening is there, the academia and industry are going together and partnering and designing some course. That way, it will have a lot of industry flavor as well as the theoretical aspects. So that way, it will become more and more what you call apt for the students to understand the real picture, right? So these are some of the initiatives which are happening today. And I think we need to think about more and more in terms of internships, workshops, and all that. That way, we can probably give more and more insights to the students such that they can be more equipped with whatever is expected from them in the industry. The other thing is like some of these things like blended learning is, I think, probably something which you might have heard about it. It is more of, we are just moving away from brick and mortar to, we are having so many options, right? Today we have online options. So we can go and take an exam, take a certification. And anywhere we can connect to any course and we can learn anything, right? So that is one thing which is really happening, and I think we need to encourage people to learn more, leveraging all these technologies. And coming to infrastructure is something which is definitely required because some of these industries are very high tech. In a sense, for them to buy a big equipment will be very costly, right? So we need to see how we can leverage the technology there. So you might have heard about augmented reality where we can mix the physical and digital things together and we can see things, right? Even you might have heard about virtual reality where you can immerse yourself into the technology and you can see how things work and all that. So those things can definitely help in terms of understanding things in these high-tech areas. So setting up these VR labs is definitely something which can help students to visualize things better, and they can definitely do understand the things more, more close to the reality and real world, right? That is what is the expectation from this second stream. The third thing is ICT Academy is already doing a lot of these social aspects, right? Like interactions, student interactions. We are doing HR conclaves and all that. So those all will help in terms of knowing what is happening in the industry, how they need to be prepared for the future journey is what is the third thing. So the conglomeration of all these things will make a student more and more equipped. So that is what I am trying to say here. So this is the way, with proper education, with proper collaboration with the industry, and with all the soft skills and behavioral aspects, I think we can make a student more complete. So now the student is ready. So what is that we need to do, right? So from here, he'll go and probably join an organization or an enterprise. So like that, probably an engineer may be joining a company. Similarly, an MBA graduate may be joining a company. So when all these people are working together in an organization, how they need to contribute in scaling the organization. So the next part of this topic is what? Accelerating the growth, right? So when we join a company, our objective and goal should be to accelerate the company. So for that, I have some small slide here to talk about. So first thing, I try to classify this into three aspects. One is your productivity and scalability and innovation. Actually, why I choose these three themes. Productivity is more from an enterprise, so that means intra-enterprise standpoint. So within the enterprise, how you want to bring the efficiencies, make the simplification possible, and all that is what is your productivity. But what is happening today is, over a period of time, as we are gathering more and more data, right? You might have heard about the data explosion. For the last 3-4 years, I think data has grown more than what we have accumulated from our history, right? So with that explosion of data, even the automation is becoming a challenge, because it is too much of automation. How much you can do? Even if you make something automated, you need to again change it, because with the data, with the trends and patterns getting changed, this has to get changed. So instead of that, why can't we transform this from automation to autonomous? What do you mean by autonomous? Autonomous is more about self-driving, right? So I think we want to, so you might have heard about self-driving cars, something like that. We are also Oracle, we are doing autonomous database. So what do we mean by that is, basically we are trying to self-provision the database, in the sense, don't need to manually install the database. You don't need to maintain the database. So it will do by itself. And that way, similarly, we have something called self-securing. So today, security is very important, because with data flowing freely here and there, I think there are always possibilities that data can be stolen, data can be misused, and all that. So self-securing is another important aspect. And the research shows that most of the times, the security issues are because we are not applying the security patch. Though the security patch is available, as we are not applying it on the right time, we are getting into these issues. So I think by making it a self-securing, what I mean to say is, it is whenever the patch is available, that applies the patch, such that we will be cutting down that 85% of challenge of getting onto the vulnerability, right? Similarly, self-repairing, if it gets down, database gets down, so it can automatically know, and it will automatically bring it up by itself. So you might be wondering, how all this is possible? And again, the buzzword is machine learning, right? You might have heard about it. Where no? It's just learning by itself, observing the patterns and all that. So it is as simple as, just to tell in a layman's term, see, typically I don't know how many of you are from computer science background, but if you look at any programming, what we do, we'll have a program, we'll have data, and we'll get an output, right? So we just need to juggle this a bit. In the sense, we'll take outputs, right? And then we'll be trying to derive the program from it. That is what is your machine learning. And the program gets matured on a continuous basis. So that is the way it all works. So that is one of the aspects. So within the enterprise, if you already scaled up, then what next? The next thing is inter-enterprise. In the sense, okay, I want to grow. Now I have all the efficiencies within my departmental level. So next thing is like, I need to grow. So how I can grow across or beyond my enterprise means, I can think about doing partnerships, right? I can think about doing diversification. I can think about getting some investments. So that is also a skill, right? That needs a lot of skill from management standpoint. That is a skill you need to know from a domain standpoint. And one important thing I would like to highlight here is, we talk a lot about investment. It's like, okay, the FDI is what we talk about. But other than FDI, what I believe is, I think we have a lot of money domestically also. But only thing is that probably that awareness is missing within a lot of people. So we see how we can mobilize that money, that domestic investments coming into the picture. So the second part is more about inter-enterprise, how you can grow, how you can scale beyond your beyond your boundaries. Then once you have come to that level also, once you say that, yes boss, I have grown, now I have various branches across the geographies, now what next? So what next is now you need to think about what is my next product, right? That comes your innovation. So for innovation, what is the oil for your innovation? Again, the data. So I don't know how many of you read this, but Walmart recently set up something called data cafes. So the way what they're done is they got into this discussion of this huge data, but how I can use it. So all these business departments are very expert in their business domain, but they're not knowledgeable about how to use this data. So what they thought was, they created these data cafes across the geography. They put data, they employed data scientists and data engineers there. And these people, the business, go to them on a coffee. They'll sit and talk about their business problem. And they'll tell boss, this is my problem, and this is what is my data. So these data scientists helps in terms of suggesting some solutions on how they can probably use this data to understand probably the consumer behavior, or to understand internal operational aspects and suggest some layouts, right? So that is what is the innovation. So typically the innovation runs on three or four parameters. One is we start with the data, and what we will do is we'll try to get some insights from the data, right? Because data as such may not be, because the business may not understand what this data is going to do, because it's very huge in number. So what they will do is they'll try to derive the insights from the data. Again, once you get the insights, the insights may be huge again in number. So how is it? Which one I need to pick? So that is where from the inside you will take a subset, which is called your ideas, right? Again, okay, you have some two or three good ideas. So but how I can probably take these ideas to a full-fledged product development? So that is what you need to do is, you need to take these ideas and try some POC or try some experiments. So once you prove that, okay, these ideas are making sense, these are feasible, these are going to deliver some benefits, then I think that those ideas will become your next products. It is a cycle again. So in the sense, your data has started, what happened? The observations, insights, ideas, experiments, and that again will become fed back to the next cycle. So this is all a cycle, innovation cycle, right? So this is the way a company first looks within itself, that is intra-enterprise, then it goes beyond its boundaries, that is inter-enterprise competing with the other enterprises, and then the third step is how it can innovate and come out with better solutions. So this is the way I think we can, if enterprise can grow or accelerate its growth using these three parameters, and if every enterprise thinks like that, I think overall we can look at as a nation we can grow, right? So that is what I'm trying to convey here. So the next point from here is, okay, now we have all these things. So we know how to augment skills, then how we can get on to accelerating growth and all. So how it is going to impact the youth, the jobs and all that? My belief is it's going to create more and more jobs. And I can quote one example. I think in Madurai there is one company. I read this in, again, Hindu newspaper only some 2 years back or so. Where, no, they were talking about, it's a small company which manufactures lenses, the cataract lenses. So that company, what it told was it has around 15 employees and they were doing around 150 lenses per day. Okay, that was their case. But they started engaging these cobots. Cobots is nothing but a smaller version of robot. It can do some standard routine tasks in the sense like sticking labels or putting things in a box or those kind of small things, right? So once they start employing these, what do you call these cobots, what happened was this journey has become more and more powerful in the sense like they started generating, instead of 150, they scaled to deliver 10,000 lenses a day. Okay, And the employees, because people worried, okay, when once these cohorts come, what happens to our jobs? No, no job losses. In fact, the number of employees increased from 15 to 600 or 700. I don't exactly remember the number. But what I'm trying to convey is actually the machine and the human beings go hand in hand. Only thing is, it will allow us to scale. It will allow us to probably, whatever the goal we are looking at, right, $5 trillion economy. I know, today our growth rate is around 6.1. That's what the recent projection. But I think if we go at that 9%, we will definitely reach. But if not 2024, we probably may take another 2-3 years. But what I'm trying to say is the technology, if you really understand it, if you really get that skill to the students, and if they can work along with the machines together, I think we all can do a great job, right? So with that, I would like to take this opportunity to again thank ICT Academy. I know my time is up now, so I think I cannot probably continue more. But yeah, I would like to take this opportunity to thank ICT Academy and Oracle Academy. But just one more second, sir. I have one last slide to show for Oracle Academy. So this Oracle Academy has, we started it 25 years ago, over 25 years. So if you are not a member of this, as educational institutions, I recommend all of you to enroll it. This is free for the institutes as well as for the students. And this is going to help you. So far, it is already having enrollment of over 15,000. And it is spread across a lot of countries, across the geographies. And the advantage is, like, you will get access to a lot of online material. So you'll be able to learn about Java, you'll be able to learn about cloud, you'll be able to learn about databases, whatnot. You can get everything. That is one part of it. Second thing is, you'll get some licenses, student licenses. So you can easily develop whatever the applications you want using all these technologies. Not only that, we have some offers, discounts on the certifications, and we have some projects which can make you more and more get that exposure real time. So all that will make you more and more your learning effective and all that. So just leverage this, and I have my colleague Anuradha Sharma here. So if you have any questions and if you want to know more about Oracle Academy, you can definitely approach her. She'll be able to help you out. So with that, I would like to thank again, and thanks for being such a nice audience. Thank you.